And welcome back to Let's Play Pillars of Eternity, The White March Part 1. Blind. This is the RPG chick. We have defeated all the enemies in here. I forgot how loud these people were for dead people. Sheesh. I did use a camping supply and camped out in the hallway somewhere and came in and we were able to defeat them then. It was quite a battle last episode. Adair fighting by himself for like the last, I don't know, it was like almost 10 minutes. It was insane. Anyway. So now we can look at all the stuff in here. There's a bunch of plaques and stuff. The good thing is, no background messages. He's gonna walk over there to read that. Meditate on those who came before you and those who go beyond you. Remember first your father and last your younger brother, but know all Pargrunin as kin. The corners of this tablet are chipped, but it's otherwise in good condition. It reads, "We plant ourselves in a strange and wild land, but remember well our roots. Though we are distant, know us still as kin." Cracks snake across this stone tablet. The edges have been worn smooth over centuries of handling. It reads, "We who stand shoulder to shoulder alongside the oldest of Kith empires send you forth. Honor us as we remember you."
Sure.
The letters on this tablet are crisp and deep, as if chiseled recently. They read, "Through our towers of stone or surrounded by gates of coral, we are Progrunin still. Write our names in your halls and your hearts." Okay. I'm going to investigate this very important looking thing later.
Margrin's fire cast
last
dark places.
Let's try to get our searching for traps and stuff. Let me just check here. Actually. So her stealth is 8. Mechanics is 10. His stealth is 4. Mechanics is 12. I'm not sure, like, to detect traps. Find and disable traps. Okay, so it is better for him to get closer and see if there's a trap because he has the better mechanic skill. Unfortunately, they don't give you a rogue character after the death of the first one, like way back in the beginning of the game.
A simple test.
Ring of Overseeing. I think one of us is using one of those. Using that. Potion of Minor Arcane Reflection. Hostile targeted spells up to 3rd level. For a total of 10 spell levels? I guess whatever equals 10, but they can't go above 3rd. Sapphire and Primal Wind. I'm not gonna bother keeping this stuff. What about this thing? 33 more Durgan cogwheels. Ooh, I bet that opens that. Tempted to rest again, but we only have one more. Okay. This globe is marked with the various Pargrunin settlements around Eora. I mean, we're not that bad off. Palagina is kind of messed up. This gilded globe has been crafted with exquisite detail. Mountains of hammered gold rise over mirror-smooth seas, and the rivers that carve the continents are as thin and neat as if they'd been carved with a razor. Three perfect sapphires mark locations in Ra'atai, Old Valia, and the Living Lands. The bronze band that circles the globe is inscribed with three repeating lines. Remember all Pergrunin, from the oldest before you to the youngest who follow you. Three perfect sapphires. Examine the globe. The rounded sapphires are just large enough for you to press them with your thumb. You test them and feel some kind of spring-loaded mechanism beneath them, but you can't determine anything further. It's supposed to be in some kind of order? From, like, where they migrated from or something? From the oldest before you to the youngest who follow you. You depress the sapphire set in the Living Lands. It sinks until it's flush with the surface of the globe. You depress the sapphire set in Old Valia. You hear a popping noise and all the sapphires spring back up. Okay. Well, I know I can do this. Like, to process of elimination. We know it's Living Lands, probably Ra'atai and then Old Valia. But I'm sure these have a clue. So, like, Gates of Coral. Gates of Coral might be Ra'atai. The oldest of Kith empires. That, and then that. Huh. Well, whatever. I'd say they went to, maybe Old Valia. Well, I don't know. Living Lands seem to work. Ra'atai? No. Okay. Old Valia. Living Lands. It clicks into place beneath the rippling ridge of a mountain. And then Ra'atai with a coral. You depress the sapphire set in Ra'atai. It clicks into place along a curving coastline. As the last sapphire snaps into place, the globe glows with the veins of brilliant blue light. Then it rotates a quarter turn. As the lights die out, you hear clanking gears and grinding stone from one side of the room. Is that door opening?
My eyes are peeled.
Uh-huh. What's this? Statues? Nothing here to attack us? Bracers of spiritual power. 10% spell damage. Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, he has one, right? Isn't he holding one? Yeah. I don't want to give up his +9 deflection.
Hmm.
This looks like it might be something that could be trapped. Hmm. Girdle of Aeotin Constitution. Oh, we have one of those. Aeotins feature in the most grotesque of folk tales. Once merely the most aggressive and unstable of ogres, Aeotins have since developed into massive monstrosities that are both larger and far less intelligent than their cousins. Eotans have two heads, one notable... You know? It might be Etten. Just like the O might be silent, or it might be Oten. Because they have consonants that are silent. They are silent in this game. Two heads, one notably smaller than the other, and when the larger of these is incapacitated, the smaller remains just enough brute cunning to keep an Eotan fighting. Named for these monstrosities, this belt provides a charm granting a similar kind of hardy perseverance. Yeah, they're creatures from Dungeons & Dragons, Ettins, that have two heads like that. Boots of Evasion, plus two reflex. I'll take a look. What kind of boots we have. I do like that. Reflex affects that, doesn't it? Dodging out of the way of physically, okay. Zealous Command. Yeah, we want to keep her with that. Stealthy. Plus two stealth. I'm guessing that happens sometimes. They get hit with a ray of pain. Cast Consecrated Ground when hit by a critical hit. I guess every time that thing's going off, you got hit with a critical hit. Happens pretty often, let me tell you. Plus one Constitution for Fulvano's boots. So what do you think? Should I give a plus one constitution and give her a plus two reflex boots? I don't know. I'm not sure. Let her keep the boots she has, yeah. I mean, it's to another attribute, and it's just one more, so I don't know. How about this? Is this trapped? Ooh, unique battle axe, leather armor. Hooded turban and some more. Well, 500 Durgan cogwheels. Are we going to be using those for anything? Or we just sell them? Or do they get converted into cash? Wodowis. Unique battle axe. Plus 0.5 to crit damage multiplier. 10% chance to cast Nature's Mark on hit or critical hit. Which is that, a full AoE for minus 10 deflection and minus 10 reflex. Plus 10 defense against disease and poison. Grants purge of toxins, 3 per rest. Which is plus 50 against poison attacks and disease. Minus 10 seconds for poison and minus 5 for disease. Pretty cool. Unfortunately, none of us are using a battle axe or are proficient in battle axe, I don't think. The Elven Kingdom of Colclan. Macaulay Colclan. Warred with the Aedir Empire for nearly two centuries before the two powers merged. During that time, many of the fiercest conflicts flared up along the edge of the Sithwood, where the two powers shared a border. The Sithwood elves used the jungle terrain to their advantage and quickly became infamous for their cunning and brutal attacks. Skirmishers would fell trees behind invading Adiran forces, while druids made more to grow in their path, confusing and stalling their foes. They would often pair these maneuvers with devastating lightning-fast attacks, surrounding lost platoons and dragging stragglers into the forest. Most notoriously, they would hang their victims from the trees to warn off further attacks. The Kulkin of the Sithwood were swift and improvised attacks quickly, owing in part to their use of everyday tools, axes, knives, and bows, as weapons of war. Axes such as Wodowis would have been used against folk and tree alike. I'm gonna put in stash. And the table. A scroll of valor and a scroll of protection. Okay, we've got this one here. I believe we have valor somewhere. That's it, huh? Look for secrets. Interesting that we can't even look at these. Alright. Well, that was interesting.
Good thing I'm freshly greased.
Grease her up. Okay, so we have this. We've gone around there. Oh, we have this tunnel here. And a door there. Well, I guess we'll go into that door. If we can.
Strengthen us with your flame, Lord Abydon. Temper us for the crucible ahead.
I really like this, all these little scenes they're adding in. It really makes the dungeons more interesting. A bronze statue of Abydon stands over incense, ash, and rusted metal tokens. Okay. So as far as we can see, we've got this little box. Scroll of Restore Critical Stamina. Someone's got one of those. Critical. Precepts and Proverbs of Abydon. Well, it's worth nothing. For every work there is a practice. Arm yourself with skill and temper your labors with patience. Strike only when your medium is ready. Do not cold work plate. Brittle steel is worse than a treacherous friend. Temper your work lest it shatter like glass. Fools praise appearance, but the master praises strength. True virtue lies in work well done. Pattern welded steel shall be folded no fewer than 7 times. The finest smith cannot shape poor metals. Set your hand to steels that have been properly treated with charcoal. Charcoal? What? Charcoal? Like a room full of discord is a forge with uneven heat. Do not let it pervert your metal. I don't want perverted metal. As the blows of the hammer speak to the steel, so the color of the steel speaks to the smith. Like a babe is heated steel, fragile and easily corrupted. Handle it gently, lest your haste twist and warp it. Do not neglect work that lies hidden and unseen, for a shoddy tang can break the blade. The wise smith works carefully and anneals but once. The careless smith weeps to find flaws after the steel has been hardened and tempered. As a blade drawn in multiple hearts, Sorry, multiple heats is work done in its proper time. I see.
What?
Hey. All right, then.
It's just... No, not you.
What?
Not trapped? Okay. Okay, another Durgan Iron Ingot and another Address Sphere. These things are pretty cool looking, huh? Alright. Let's see. I was trying to get something out of my eye. This one we can't look at? We can't look at this sign or plaque, whatever. Okay. For some reason, I want to save this ramp thing for last, so I'm gonna actually go this way. There's nothing along the way that we're gonna bumble into. It'll be a bundle that bumbles into things. Alright, that way.
I'll see what I can find.
Oh, these are the... I don't like that they're there. They're gonna turn into stuff and attack us. Maybe this is the way to the forge, though.
Quickly! There's not much time!
There's a door. Let's save here. I don't know what we're up to. 45, 44, something.
We've never introduced this much essence into the White Forge. It...
Abydon gave us the tools, Vasil. We've got to make them work.
What's all this? Books and pages scrawled with equations and measures of essence are scattered across the table as if someone went through them in a hurry. Potion of Bulwark against the elements and Primal Flame. Is that the forge, is it? I don't know what that is. It's not marked with anything. Durgan Iron Ingot, and on the Binding of Souls. I believe we have that book. Let's just check. Oh no, maybe not. Oh. The margins of this text are scribbled with notes and references. The ink-stained pages appear to have seen much use in earlier times. It says, the removal and transference of souls is a practice both ancient and sophisticated. There is evidence that the Inguithans were particularly adept at all this, but... At this, right? Yet few details have survived them. Someone scrolled Annals of the Pargrunin, paragraph 382-6. I have that book. Let me write that down. Maybe with the reference. It'd be cool if the books actually have a, you know, other than lore, they have a practical use within the game. What is known is that the removal of a soul is a difficult process, and one that requires an expert hand and precise tools for any chance of success. Early attempts on a test pool of 138 goats left most of the subject with maimed or fractured souls. In all but two of the 11 instances where the soul was successfully removed, the essence dissipated before scholars could capture it. The words "transfer to holding a vessel" are written and underlined in the margin. The process requires conductive materials, copper and adra, specifically. Immersion in water is important to ensure that the soul is drawn in a steady and uniform manner, with no distortions or breakages. A warped soul is, at best, useless and at worst, unpredictable. So like that bath that they have right there. An arrow points from this paragraph to a scrunched note. Extraction pool in CR, 18 feet wide by 3 feet deep. CR. Extraction point in CR. I don't know what CR means. We have since mastered the process of soul transference and have seen the benefits of infusing forged work with the essence of animals and wilder. What remains to be seen is whether we might see greater gains from using the souls of Keth, where we would procure the appropriate subjects, and how much personality and autonomy we would want to leave intact in such cases. A string of notes winds around and below this paragraph, beginning with quote-unquote criminals, prisoners of war, volunteers, and ending with forge guardians in black letters. Wow. No secrets? Check for secrets before you mess with the pool. I would not be surprised if messing the pool wakes these two up and the other two down the hall, and they'll all attack us. Your skin prickles as you approach the vat. It teems with soul energy, with lives spent and stored thrice over. Essence roils like churning water, running over ancient pipes and gears. But there, within the vat itself, lies a heavy stone disc, rune-engraved and pale as bone. Reach for the object. You feel a chill run up your arm the moment your fingers brush the disc's surface. Whispers are up from the stone around you, and out of that chorus rises a single, steady voice.
Stop! These methods belong to us! To the Pargrunin!
What if I say please? What happened here?
You would steal from us? From the... Abydon himself! You will regret your trespass!
The angry hiss surrounds you. Oh, brother. You hear a grinding, clicking noise in the hall. Something moans and snarls outside.
Eyes open.
Yeah, eyes open.